Hello there and welcome. I'm Christian Antwee, one of the staff members here at Central Presbyterian Church. Thank you for joining us for our music and meditation. If you are new with us, say hello in the chat box of whichever medium you are choosing to participate with us and allow us to welcome you. If you would like to have more information about our worshiping community, please hop over to our website, cpcatlanta.org, and click on our About tab. And contact us. This will allow you to contact any of the pastors on staff and find ways for us to connect with you. We have many ways to connect and opportunities to serve, and that can be found under our Connect tab. If you're joining us outside of our live stream, we encourage you to still comment or contact us. But before we get started, may you join me in prayer. God, we are here virtually, but spiritually, we are at your table. As your spirit walks among us, may it move and transform us to be people of your will. Change can be difficult, but it's not impossible with your divine grace. We are people that are seeking to be part of your movement in the world. Be with us, God, as we continue to dive deeper into a relationship with you. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. In our traditional service later on, we will be hearing from our children's ministry. This week, we will have the service be our Children's Sabbath, and the theme happens to be a whole new world. Every time I say the theme, I find myself wanting to sing Aladdin's A Whole New World. In a way, I spiritually resonate with the classic. Let's take a look at the second stanza of the song. Don't worry. I will spare you from my singing. But listen to these words as we will compare them to our Old Testament texts of the day. A whole new world, a fantastic point of view, no one to tell us no or where to go or say we're only dreaming. A whole new world, a dazzling place I never knew, but when I'm way up here, it is crystal clear that now I'm in a whole new world with you. Let us as well hear from Isaiah chapter 43, verses 18 and 19. Forget the former things, do not dwell on the past. See, I'm making a new thing. Now it springs up, do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. So, now, if you're not familiar with the story of Aladdin, here's the briefest recap of the plot. A young person named Aladdin is poor and experiences the world in a certain way. He is called a street rat by many, and he meets a young princess named Jasmine, and as her title gives away, she is of royalty, and with that, experiences the world in a far different way than Aladdin. Though, we see that she is craving an experience that is truly different from her upbringing, she encounters Aladdin pretending to be part of her world. The journey of Aladdin and Jasmine is a typical Disney fairy tale, but when we get introduced to the iconic song, we find Aladdin's promise to show Jasmine a whole new world, one that is vastly different than what she is exposed to, paralleling to Isaiah, where we must observe the new things God is doing. We may not be on a magic carpet ride, but we are experiencing an unusual encounter in our world today. As we dive deeper into our meditation, let's talk more about an aspect of what all humans struggle with, and possibly is some of the toughest things for us to go through. Learning something new and experiencing change. I, for one, was someone who thought that I loved and thrived during change. Around my mid-20s, though, I started realizing that I am indeed a creature of habit and enjoy the comfort of familiar places and routines. I feel that many of us can probably relate to that. If you have been Presbyterian for a while, you have probably have heard the nickname, the Frozen Chosen. As well, learning something in a specific field is an easy task, and some say that they love the challenges that come with learning something new. But as we look deeper into the psychology of learning, we see that at early ages, we develop learning pathways, ways that help us process information and retain it and utilize it. As we get older, those pathways start to become very rigid and set. So, for example, when we learn our first language, we develop a set ways of understanding the rules, grammar, spelling, the exceptions to the rules, and the meanings behind the slang and cultural nuances that are particular to our first language. If you're like me and try to pick up a second language later in life, let's say your 20s, it's not impossible, but it's a lot harder than the first time. Creating new pathways to obtain a new form of understanding often meant letting go of how we once understood something else. What about changing habits? Switching up our daily routine or lifestyle? Changing habits is an extremely difficult task. We are made to be creatures of habit, and we love our routines. Those routines are traditions that sometimes make it difficult to experience something new. Did you know that it takes 21 days to consciously think and actively do to change a habit? Then it takes another 90 days to solidify it so that it becomes our new habit. An example of changing habits in my life was losing weight. Have any of y'all intentionally tried to lose weight? It is a habit-changing and life-changing journey. Each day for 6 months, I had to consciously choose to wake up at 5 a.m. to extend the hours of my day and actively choose different food consumption habits that were different from my high metabolism college days. If you could, can you take some time during this meditation to type out one of your lifestyle changing habits? If you feel comfortable, tell us about how difficult it was or how easy it might have been for you. To be real, we can recognize that we are hardwired to be averse to change. We seek and cling to comforts of knowing what is going to happen and to be in control of our situations. We find ourselves in a bit of a quandary when we hear and read Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, God's good, pleasing, and perfect will. Do not conform to the patterns of this world. As I read and meditated on this text, I find myself focusing so much on do not conform. Part of me wants to cheer and said, yeah, absolutely. Do not conform. Be your own self. That's how it should be. But as I dig deeper into my soul, start looking around my feelings and looking through my understanding, I recognize that ultimately I do conform because I seek comfortability. It taunts my soul as I look at both the words to conform and comfort, and I see the similarities where they are just two letters apart. Kind of like having a second cousin twice removed. Related, but very different in a way. To conform, according to Webster, is to comply with rules, standards, or laws, to behave according to socially acceptable conventions or standards, to be similar in form or type, to agree. Comfort is defined as a state of physical ease and freedom from pain or constraint. The easing of alleviation of person's feelings of grief or distress. Not saying that all comfort is bad, but when we do seek comfort, it's hard to change. When I actively choose to change my routines and transform my mind and my heart, I usually don't find comfort. we don't find comfort in not conforming. Part of my upbringing, I went to a private Christian school in Florida where I received a great handle of Bible knowledge, but I do have to criticize one of their teachings. It was how being a person of faith was going to be a prosperous event. I was taught a lot of the benefits of having a relationship with Jesus, and occasionally was told that others would persecute me for being Christian, tactitiously forgetting to teach that Christians have been persecuting other people for many of centuries. But I was never told that being a true, authentic Christian is to be on a path where God leads you, and on the road, and possibly even at the destination, it won't be comfortable. It wasn't until probably college that I realized that usually when God is moving you, you're being moved out of comfort and into a place God specifically wants you to be in. A place where you are not to conform, but to be transformed. The example I remember hearing most likely in a Montreat setting was the traditional Lord's Prayer, specifically the line, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." The conversation was triggered by our comfort with prayer and our willingness to often pray words that sound great. Phrases that we have grown comfortable with, but haven't really thought about. So taking time to intentionally read and hear and pray the Lord's Prayer has struck me to this point. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Though I don't have the ultimate knowledge of what this really means, I can comfortably say that our human comforts don't align with God's will. If we are to truly make God's will happen here on earth, we must also be moved with God and recognize the systemic issues of our world that takes us away from fulfilling the prayer that we so confidently profess. Friends, if I can be honest, 2020 sort of has been a Romans 12 kind of year for me. What I mean by this is that I feel within the marrow of my bones that God is moving in a big way, and God is moving us along with God in this very politically charged environment right now. We have to remember to not think of ourselves more highly than we ought, but rather to think of ourselves with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of us. We must remember in a time that is so divisive that each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same functions. So in Christ, we, though many, form one body. And each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. We are created to be in community with one another. And does that feel comfortable? For me, it most certainly does not. And if you've been following along with me so far, you can probably predict where I'm going. Since it is not comfortable, most likely God is moving me into a space not to conform, but to be transformed. Recently, I was served a bit of humble pie. As racism, both systemic and interpersonal, has been in the forefront of our country's news and society, I have had a very hardened heart. I grew to be very Pharaoh-like in this situation. As I've talked to many friends and colleagues about this, they have given me the grace and permission to be like this. But during this summer, I participated in a social distant community group called the Junction ATL. I got to lead a few discussions on the book, Better, Waking Up to Who We Could Be, by a local Atlantan Black author named Melvin Bray. In the final chapter, Melvin writes, "All of the world's problems, racism, sexism, misogynist, homophobia, transgenderphobia, xenophobia, and other disruptions of recognizing human worth could be solved by being relational." I read it, reread it, put the book down, walked away from it, ready to denounce all the other content of the book. I was livid and very much ready just to be done with it. I felt he had to be wrong, because why should I be relational to someone who fundamentally opposes me because of the color of my skin or my beliefs? Why should I associate with anyone who hates someone because of their orientation or living the life God blessed them with? It was a hard pill to swallow, and I'm still wrestling with it. But the truth is, I find comfort in being with like-minded people. I find comfort in being surrounded by people who have similar beliefs. So with my hardened heart, I quickly put it away, ready to deny all the contents of this book up to that point. But I know that I shouldn't turn away from something that isn't comfortable for me. Verse 9 through 18 of Romans 12. "Love must be sincere, hate what is evil, cling to what is good, be devoted to one another in love, honor one another above yourselves, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer, share with the Lord's people who are in need, practice hospitality, bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice, mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone." We are not to conform to this world, but we are to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. As God is moving this world, God is also moving us out of our comfort. May we be led on a magic carpet ride to see a new fantastic point of view. And through our transformation, may we also transform this world so that God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
You say there's so much you don't know. You need to go and find yourself. You won't be the only one. to me. When you high, I'm taking loads. You can have and I can flow. And we'll take it slow and grow as we go.
Friends, as we conclude our time together, I leave you with this blessing. May God bless you with discomfort at easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships, so that you may live deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people, so that you may work for justice, freedom, and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, and war, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and turn their pain into joy. And may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in this world, so that you can do what others claim cannot be done, to bring justice and kindness to all our children and the poor. Amen.
Jesus, light of a joy, surround.